Hey everyone, I'm a little bit overdue for a technical video blog, so I thought I'd chime in with a little footage this lovely Saturday morning in South Florida. Should be at the beach right now, whatever. Anyway, I was looking at some old CD-ROMs that I had burned to pull some audio data off of them. And here's the CD, okay? Kind of has a funky label, and it's called Cool, okay? And the bottom line is that I put the CD into the Macintosh, and it wouldn't mount. The Mac didn't recognize it at all. And I've had this problem before with a few other older CD-ROMs. Anyway, the point I'm trying to make here is that I know a lot of you are warehousing a lot of data, whether it's photos that you're taking or collecting, or music that you're making, or perhaps you're converting your music library to MP3s. You're taking raw video footage on cameras like I'm using, MPEG cameras and whatnot, and you're burning them off to CD to archive them. Well, I want to give you a heads up. These CDs, and I guess DVDs as well, they don't last forever. Now, I started burning back in 1995. Wow. The first burner I purchased was from a company called Pinnacle. It was a SCSI, an SCSI external burner. I think it was 2x speed, so it took a good, you know, half hour to burn a disc, and it was hooked up to my PowerMac 7500. The burner cost me $1,500. The burners, when they first came out, they were $5,000. Then they went to $3,000. Then they went down to $1,500. That's when I jumped in, and the blanks, when I jumped in, were $10 a blank CDR. Wow. Burning was like a religious experience because, you know, burning $10 media. And basically what happened was you would load all the content onto the hard drive, and, you know, you had to get a big hard drive. You had to have a 650 meg or more hard drive so you can arrange everything. But you'd load the data onto the hard drive. You then meticulously, you know, name everything so it's upper and lower case, and you'd arrange the folders so when you open the CD, the folders would be in a, you know, properly arranged so you can, you know, get through the content easier. And then what you would do is you would have to defrag the hard drive to make the throughput quicker so you wouldn't have a buffer underrun error when you were burning the CD. So the whole burn thing was like a religious experience. It really was, you know, back in 95. And you did the burn, and I remember the very first burn I did was an audio CD. And it worked in the car. It skipped on the home stereo system. It didn't work in the boombox. I mean, it was like, you know, it was very frustrating. But obviously the technology got better and the software got better. I think I was using, you know, Roxio Toast version 1.0. Actually, it wasn't under the Roxio name. It was under a German company, Astarte, something like that. Anyway, and also in the same theme of what I'm discussing, hard drives. As you all know, hard drives are mechanical devices. So that 300 gig drive that has multiple platters that are spinning at whatever, 80 miles an hour, that thing is going to fail, really. I mean, the average lifespan I have for my hard drives, maybe 3 to 5 years, they will fail. They're mechanical devices, all right? So we know that our hard drives are going to fail, and of course we go into denial. And I'm also telling you that because I have CDs burned from 1995, some of them are just gone. I mean, the material, I think, deteriorates. It oxidizes if it's exposed to heat or light that damages the media. Just sitting in a case. I mean, these things are on a shelf in a case. And like I said, the data's just gone. I mean, I lost some family audio data. I mean, my father singing happy birthday to my brother. I'm a little pissed off, to tell you the truth, that I don't have that. I'm not saying live in the past and live around this old data. We're all certainly making new memories, but certainly if you're taking footage or you're filming something or you're recording something, you don't want to lose it. So anyway, I had another disc that failed, and I thought perhaps, you know, one of the theories is that the labels that we put on these things, that the glue on the label damages the media. I mean, if you look at, I mean, here's a CompUSA disc, all right? And the label on the CompUSA disc, I mean, that is the media that you're recording onto. You're recording, you know, the lasers hitting beneath it. But if you scratch this you know, it's screwed. It's destroyed. That's why you can't use a ballpoint pen when you write on these things. Anyway, I soaked this disc in hot water, and I took the label off. I thought maybe something with the graphic that I used was confusing the laser. But anyway, this, whatever. Can't read the data. So where do we go from here? All right, there's a couple of options as far as preserving your data. One option is to just buy some hard drives, and if you have some really critical data, just let it, you know, record it to the hard drive and then put the hard drive, you know, off-site or in a closet or whatever, and just let it sit and rot there. Of course, if you don't turn the hard drive on every once in a while, I'm sure that thing will mechanically stiffen up and eventually break down. But that's one option because the price of hard drives have come down. Another strategy that I use is I will traditionally use a RAID array in software, whether you're on a Mac system, because OS X does it, and so does Windows XP. But you can take two drives that are of similar size or similar volume size and chain them together as a redundant drive. So when it writes to drive A, it's also writing to drive B. So the chances of both drives failing at the same time is unlikely. Doesn't mean that, I mean, if you still accidentally throw the file out or it gets corrupt, it's going to be redundantly corrupt. I mean, so there's a problem with that as well. So archival, you know, external hard drives that you put away, using RAID arrays in software, that's also a good solution. I'm also using tape backup. I'll show you the drive. Here is a SCSI-based VXA packet drive that I hooked up to the G5 system. This is the computer I call Melody because it runs the music studio, but I also use it as the backup, the system for doing backups. And I back up via, you know, gigabit Ethernet from the machines in the home. And the tapes look like this, and they come in various lengths. And at the highest length with my particular drive, I got the high-end drive, you can put 300 gigs on a tape. And tape pretty much lasts for a long time. Now, I have my music library, which is over 110 gigs, I have it backed up on a couple of tapes. You know, it spans a couple of different tapes. So at least all that music I've been ripping is safe on these tapes, and I can easily restore it if the RAID array fails or it gets corrupted or whatever. Anyway, let me show you a few other things. Another type of medium for archival storage is a magneto-optical drive. Now, this is from Fujitsu. Here's the case. The name of the drive is called the Dynamo, and it holds 2.3 gigabytes. This is what the media looks like. It's pretty neat. Basically looks like a little bit of a oversized floppy. Okay, there's the media. And 2.3 gigs. So this is a hybrid technology. It's magnetic-based, but it uses optical. It uses lasers for doing the tracking. But it does apply some type of a magnetic property to the medium. And this is what the drive looks like. There's the Dynamo Magneto Optical Drive. It's pretty small, and it's USB, I don't know if it's USB 1 or USB 2. And this is hooked up to my G4. And from what I've read and from what I've tested, that Magneto Optical has a really long shelf life, and you can re-record it. The problem with the Magneto Optical is that it's very, very slow. It's very slow, but the data is really safe on these particular disks. So when I have paid software that I download and, you know, I archive the email with the serial numbers and whatnot, I typically put them on these because I know they're not going anywhere. All right, so that's another type of medium for archival storage. Here is an FF class MaxStor 1 terabyte external hard drive. And this particular drive offers both FireWire 800, 400, as well as USB 2.0. Basically, the way it delivers 1 terabyte is it has two internal 500 gigabyte drives, and through software, talking to the controller internal to the drive, you can either set it up as a RAID. Where it chains the two drives together for speed, so the 500 and the 500 equals a terabyte, or you can also put it into mirrored mode, where it just redundantly writes from one to the other, and that doesn't have to be done by the software on the computer. It's done internally with the drive's controller. The current drives that are out now from MaxStor, they have it actually up to 1.5 terabytes, a pair of internal 750s, And soon, of course, you're going to see from Matt's store a 2 terabyte drive, because I don't recall which manufacturer now has released a 1 terabyte, you know, SATA hard drive. So, you know, big changes in recording density. I think the big leap in the recording density is because they're using a technique called perpendicular recording. So they align the magnetism perpendicular as opposed to, I guess, horizontal, so they can just pack more data in the same amount of space. So you're going to be seeing some good increases in hard drive technology and speed as we move further. I'll tell you the truth, I thought they kind of peaked out once they hit, you know, 500 gigs, but I was absolutely wrong. Okay, so what else can we do as far as archival? Take a look at this, because you know I got to be on the bleeding edge of things. There it is, folks. From Otherworld Computing, I have my external Blu-ray DVD burner. Blu-ray packs 25 gigabytes per layer, and you can have a maximum of 2 layers, so a maximum of 50 gigabytes per piece of media. Right now, the blank 25s, write once, are down to $14. So if you look at you know, cost per storage, is actually pretty good. And the 50 gigabytes are about, you know, it's about double at $27, $28. And here's an actual piece of Blu-ray media. It is, well, kind of blue. Whatever. The flip side, it's you know, very, very dark. So I'm going to be using the Blu-ray discs to archive my video footage that I'm taking with the MPEG camera, the camera that I'm filming with now, the Sanyo C6. Now, I have it backed up onto some CDRs, and of course I have it backed up on dual-layer DVDs, but I'm just going to take all of those, put them onto one of these Blu-ray pieces of media, and I'll just be done with it. Supposedly, hopefully, the shelf life on the Blu-ray is supposed to be very, very good. You know, I'll come back to it in 15 years and let you know. All right, let's take a look at some of the other CDs I have. So there it is. There's the first CD-ROM I burned, labeled Archive 1. And notice I didn't even label the actual media. I just put a sticker, you know, I just put a sticker on the case. And what's below it? Below it is an Apple system software disk. It's OS 8.6. And there's another fine classic CD-ROM. Anyway, let's go live. Now, this is a Mitsui brand disc, and the it uses a gold type of media as opposed to the silver. And from what I've been reading, the gold is supposedly a hell of a lot better because this oxidizes, and this either doesn't or it doesn't do it as quick as this. So from what I've been reading on the web, and actually they reference the Mitsui brand, the Mitsui band, which is more expensive, is a lot better for archiving. So anyway, here we go. Let's pop the disc in. We're doing this live. Let's see if it mounts. There it is. Archives 1. And it did indeed mount. There it is. All right, this was burned Saturday, October 12th, 1996, at 6 o'clock p.m. Good to see what I was doing on a Saturday night. I was burning CDRs. Whatever. I actually found a picture of the Pinnacle burner that I used back in 96. That's what it looked like. It was actually a pretty cool looking burner, and it was SCSI, and it burned, like I said, CDs at a 2x speed. So here we have a disc that's 11 years old that does indeed mount, and the contents of the disc do indeed come up, which is kind of cool. Let's take a listen to some of the sound clips that were recorded probably before 1996, but were archived on this CD-ROM in 1996. I'm sure it was extremely important audio data.
Lucas.
Ah, bonsoir.
Bridge to Captain Kirk.
Thank you, God bless you, and
get the fuck out of the country,
you medieval dickweed!
Totally useless. You know what's really funny? I'm using a program called SoundEdit 16 from Macromedia. I had to install a patch, but it actually runs under the OS 9 layer. I'm running this on the old G4 system, but it runs just fine. It was a very, very good audio editor at the time, and that's what we, you know, would use for cutting and pasting and cleaning up audio and whatnot. And, of course, you know, way back when, you know, I was pioneering making annoying loops. And little did we know that loop editing and looping audio clips is a very popular way of making music now. I'll give you a sample of some of the things that were pretty annoying that I very meticulously looped. Wow, that is really freaking annoying. Now here's a great sound clip. This is something from the 80s, Andrew Dice Clay talking about California, all right, and, you know, why it's such a great place, you know, to live with your family.
Dykes, faggots, pimps, hookies, mass murderers, drug addicts, earthquakes, great place to bring up a family, huh?
You got the right soul, baby. Love the way you turn me on. You got the right soul, baby. You're the reason why I sing this song.
You know, another way of protecting your data is to simply, you know, mark the date when the CD or DVD is burned, and spot check your media every maybe 2 or 3 years and reburn them. All right. Now, of course, when you do that, and I do that with some media, you have to destroy the old ones, you know, especially if it has like critical financial or personal data on it. So I'm going to show you, I mean, there's two ways to destroy a disk, or three. I mean, one is you can kind of crack it up in the garbage pail, but you get a lot of particles all over the place, and sometimes you can cut your hand. Some of the shredders now will actually accept a CD or a DVD, so you can shred them, but the particular shredder has to be able to, you know, take that media. Or the third way, and I was inspired by my YouTube friend, Multimedia Jay, in his series, Will It Nuke, is to put the media in the microwave. Now, kids, don't do this at home. Really, don't do it at home. Do it at your friend's house. Screw up his microwave. Anyway, let's nuke a CD. Tax return data, April 2000 to 2004. We can definitely get rid of this CD. Glass of water. CD with the magnetic, yeah, with the media facing up. Power is on high. 7 seconds. Should be more than enough. And let's see what happens. Ooh, it makes a lovely piece of art, and that is definitely, definitely no longer a readable disc. Wow, my kitchen smells like burnt offerings, so make sure you keep a can of Lysol handy. That concludes my segment on storage, backup, medium, etc. Next week, we're going to be learning some safety techniques and tips on properly hang gliding over active volcanoes. You're right. See you later, guys. I appreciate the comments and the subscriptions. Thanks for checking in, and more to come real soon. Take care.